Goodrich Memorial Library. Welcome to the snapshot event. Melodic Wanderlust. Duke Ellington's Far East Suite with Reuben Jackson. We extend our thanks to our partners with Vermont Humanities, as well to the generous underwriters who make it possible for such a rich and robust programming. The sponsor of our entire snapshot season is the Vermont Department of Libraries and the Institute of Museum and Library Services. Tonight, we come together from across the state to listen, to learn, hopefully to be inspired. The next snapshot event is going to be hosted by the Norwich Public Library, and that is Coming of Age in Vermont, Transits of Youth in a Complex Interwoven World. That will be on October 18th at 7 p.m. Be sure to register online to receive a link to the live stream event. I also want to tell you about two programs that are coming up here. Crazy busy week. Wednesday we had Lieutenant Governor come and we read some banned books. We had a little chit chat. It was lovely. We have our Vermont Humanities program. Friday, a new author is doing a book launch here Friday at 6:15 here in the assembly room. And then Saturday from 1 to 4, we're going to make stuff out of old discarded jewelry. Old jewelry and tiles. It's free, it's fun. Come one, come all. It'll be a good time. So, and now it is my pleasure to introduce to you our speaker. Reuben Jackson is an archivist with the University of the District of Columbia's Felix E. Grant Jazz Archives. He's also a poet whose work has been included in over 40 anthologies from 2012 until 2018. He was host of Friday Night Jazz on Vermont Public Radio. How cool is that? Without further ado, Reuben.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming, first of all, and I'd like to thank Vermont Humanities for tapping me on the shoulder and saying, hey, you want to come back? This is my second post-birthday trip to Vermont, and it's, it's a pretty nice place to get older, even, you visit briefly, and so thank you, and thank you all for being here. What we'll do tonight is, I'll say this. When I hosted Friday Night Jazz here, and people would, I was interviewed once or twice, and this guy said, how'd you get into radio? And I said, well, the radio show is, it's a high-tech extension of what I did as a kid. And what I mean by that is, I would play records in the basement. I mean, I know a lot of you all remember stereos. And let me just also say, it's great to be in a place with an older demographic, because sometimes you make references to things and people go, once I did a reading here a couple years ago, I mentioned the comedian Imogene Coca, and everybody laughed, and I said, my people means a lot of things. Anyway, but what I said to the interviewer was, I would play records in the basement with my friends. We'd play the hit records, but my father liked what we call jazz, and I'd also play stuff for them, which wasn't necessarily on the hit parade. And they'd look at me like, oh, there he goes again. It's some strange music. So I said, this program is also, my stint here was like a nerd's revenge. But so tonight is a further extension of, you're in the basement with me, and if the music gets too loud, my mother, wherever she is, will like, she'll bang on the ceiling. It's too loud, turn it down. Anyway. I've been thinking about this work, and in doing that, the 20 years I worked as a curator with the Duke Ellington collection at the Smithsonian, and how things change, but they don't. So this is a record which was released in 1967, The Summer of Love, in many respects. It's based upon an extended work. Duke Ellington and his longtime arranging composing partner, Billy Strayhorn. It's called Impressions of the Far East. It was written, inspired by things and experiences they had during a State Department tour in 1963, the fall of 1963, which was interrupted by the events of November 22nd, 1963. A lot of people nodding, you all know, President Kennedy was assassinated, so the tour was cut short. But the orchestra went to, among other places, and this is where history is kind of ironic and interesting. So Lebanon, Syria, Iran, also to Japan. But what we have is, it's an Ellington Strayhorn collaboration called the Far East Suite. Now, a couple things I'll say before we get to the music. Think 1967, many, quote, big bands were, and it's understandable because as my seventh grade music teacher once said, there is music and there is the music business. So a lot of bands were doing what they could to stay afloat, to stay relevant somewhat. And that often meant kind of, you know, nostalgic recreations of pieces from a certain period. Duke Ellington always told interviewers who'd say, what's your favorite piece? And he'd say, the next one. And I think what you have here is great evidence of the continued creativity, this beautiful restlessness which marks, well, because it still exists, marks Ellington's work. But again, I couldn't help but think about where they went, this country's relationships with some of the places documented for, as Duke Ellington liked to say, the people with the ears. And what I would just do is, I'll tell you a bit about each piece. We're not gonna hear them all. Some of them are fairly lengthy, but I'll leave you with this before we start the music. There's a quote associated with the saxophonist Lester Young. It's 1959, right before his passing. He told this interview, he said, you've got to be original, man. And I think this music is a testimony to, it swings and all that, but it's original. And, you know, it's a way of documenting innovative composition within an accessible framework, which is hard to do. I mean, talk about multitasking, you know. So that's kind of it for the introduction. What we'll do, of course, to start, as Julie Andrew said in The Sound of Music, start at the beginning, a very good place to start. This piece is called Tourist Point of View. Now, I hear certain things when I play this, and you know, think about anticipation. And I'll just say this too. 1968, Duke Ellington wrote a suite which became the Latin American Suite. The initial title was Mexican Anticipation. So, you know, you're a tourist, what's the point of view being expressed here? No words. But two of Ellington's major interpreters are featured here. Paul Gonzalez on tenor saxophone. The high note trumpet stuff you'll hear is Cat Anderson. So this is Exhibit A, as they might say. This is Tourist Point of View. Thank you. Okay, again, that's the opening movement of the Far East Suite. I left out a couple of key contributors. Bassist John Lamb. You also heard Harry Carney on baritone saxophone. Now, some of you may know that Duke Ellington's initial passion was he wanted to be a commercial artist. He had got a scholarship to Pratt Institute in New York. He was playing piano at the same time, and of course, he was a you know the old expression, the silver-tongued devil. He told an interviewer, he said, well, you know, one day I was fooling around with the piano, and he said, there was a beautiful young woman at this end of the piano. And he said, you know, I ain't been no sign painter since. But he always, and you know, you think of tonal color when you talk about music. I think he's one of the great tonal colorists, and I would opine that he used soloists like one would use colors with a palette. And so you could think of, you know, Paul Gonzalez on tenor saxophone adding something. Harry Carney, again, Cat Anderson with that high, that upper register trumpet work. And I think titles like Tourist Point of View leave room for us as listeners to, you know, what do we hear? Are we going somewhere? Where are we going? And going back to the idea of originality, something like, you know, a title like the Far East Suite is understandably could be fodder for well-meaning but kind of cliched approaches to what the music of, quote, the East would sound like. But, you know, when you have two great minds like Duke Ellington and Billy Strayhorn, you come up with something like this, you know, something to, I'd say, you know, whet the appetite in your ears, to mix a metaphor. But that was my undergrad major, mixed metaphors. Okay, so the second movement, and this features another one of the major contributors to the Ellington sound. It's clarinetist Jimmy Hamilton. This piece is titled Mina, M-I-N-A-H, Mina Bird, in quotes, Bluebird of Delhi. So here's the first overt nod to, you know, a region, a city. And Duke Ellington did a number of pieces associated with birds. I would also add, you know, like Langston Hughes, the poet, had a two-volume autobiography. I Wonder as I Wander, and then volume two was the big C, S-E-A. I think Ellington wondered as he wandered, and, you know, part of the result of that is what we're hearing tonight and what you can hear once you take, what's the term they use now, a deep dive into Ellingtonia. So this is the second movement. Again, Jimmy Hamilton is on clarinet. It's called Mina, or Bluebird of Delhi. If I can get the right. Okay, so we go to, here I ask for this and then I don't know how to do it. Isn't that just like a man? Okay. One, and then we'll go to two. Three, no. Just a second here. No, that's not it. Bear with me here. Let's see. That's certainly not it. Okay, volume.
White noise gone wild.
What's that?
That sounds like white noise gone wild.
Yeah. From the Jimi Hendrix program. Nope, not that.
I blew a speaker once listening to the Stassmangle band.
That's good. I knew I liked you. Okay. This is minor. So again, you know, the Duke Ellington Orchestra, maybe a side of Ellington you haven't been privy to. Jimmy Hamilton on clarinet, and you know, how do you take, I remember reading an interview with his arranging composing partner, Billy Strayhorn, and the question was, you know, how do you capture, you know, what's the process from inspiration to getting something on paper and all the tweaking and that kind of thing, which he says, well, the inspiration part is easy, like you'll see or hear a bird sing, and he was referring to, in this case, minor, which we just heard. He said, but then the translation is where the work comes in. So, you know, the question, how do you make something pleasing for the people with the ears, as Duke Ellington liked to say, and utilize these wonderful instrumentalists in his orchestra? Now, I can tell you from 20 years of helping to process this man's papers, it wasn't, well, to quote the title of a book by Mel Torme, it wasn't all velvet. Ellington was kind of a control freak. He would sometimes take pieces, not give credit, and, you know, like any tempestuous relationship, sometimes players would leave, they'd come back, and one such person said, you know, where could you go after you left Duke Ellington? Because it's, and as someone like an erstwhile musician, I would take a moment in between processing the stuff and look at scores and parts, and I think, wow. You know, some bands, your first trumpet, second trumpet, and, you know, the part works, those parts were like vistas, you know, and you're thinking, you know, like you could think, like how many ways can you get from here to Montpelier? You could take one road, you could take another. You're going the same place, but the way you go is so wonderful. And sometimes my colleagues will say, what are you doing? And I'll say, look at the fifth measure here. See, it's like being in the basement again. The B flat's going here, and they go, oh, God, it goes again. But it's, you know, it's what you do and how you do it. And I think we've heard two examples of that. I forgot to mention this at the outset, but I hope I'll leave time for questions or observations or anything like that, you know, before we part. But in fact, is there anything now anybody wants to? Yes, ma'am. Yeah, it could well have been. I mean, another thing to consider is, at the time this was released, it was Billy Strayhorn's contributions were not prominently featured, which was a source of tension between them. I mentioned Billy Strayhorn too because his initial aspiration was to be, you know, a quote, a classical composer, pianist, and actually black music is riddled with people who had those inspirations, but the doors were closed. Nina Simone, I could go on and on. So it's quite possible. And one thing that Ellington and Strayhorn were adamant about, well, A, excellence, which I think we're hearing so far, but also labels meant, like Duke Ellington did not like the word jazz because he found it too limiting. And I remember an interview with Ellington and Strayhorn, and the interviewer asked something about jazz, and you could hear them going like, And Strayhorn said, okay, there are 88 keys on this piano over here. Which key is a jazz key? So, you know, when the palette, when you've got this wonderful palette in front of you, you know, melodically or harmonically, great players, and your imagination is wide open, but you also have the skill. So like Quincy Jones called great music, soul and science. When you've got the soul and the science, and you know, this is someone who wrote with the talents of the players we've heard so far in mind. So it's a wonderful, there's a word in term in Portuguese, if I botch it, forgive me, it's a mistura fina, fine mixture. And that's, I think that's consistent throughout the Ellington canon, if you will. So again, that's Bluebird of Delhi. Now, I'm sorry.
I was just going to say that this has been one of my all-time favorite albums. When I lived in places where I'd have dinner parties, I would start the night with this album.
Wow.
But with this one, the minor piece, it illustrates for me one of the things that I love so much about Ellington, and keeping with what you just described, as far as not wanting to be limited, but how he, like when I hear that piece, even though he's inspired by a bird in the East somewhere, I hear pure African Americana. And he does such a beautiful job. And I think this is a testament of all great musicians, great artists, regardless of ethnicity, where you can kind of, like W.B. Du Bois talked about having the double consciousness, especially as Americans, where you can. You can give a nod to Isfahan, but you can also bring yourself along with it. And with that minor bird and the cadence of the drumming, I always immediately heard, I don't know any more polite word for it, but what used to be called pimp walking. I hear the you know, struts.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
And
yeah.
I love that.
You know, I don't think there was, that's thank you. I don't think there was ever an either or and then some.
And something completely new and different.
Yes,
and
yes.
And exciting. I've never heard that before. It really, I'm going to go home and put it on YouTube.
Sure, thank you. Last thing I'll say before we go to the next piece is, unless someone else has a question or a comment. Now think, you know, this is the late 1960s. The black consciousness is rising. And this is an aesthetic comment about, you know, Duke Ellington always kept his hair straight. And there was kind of a checklist at a time, what constitutes blackness, what constitutes your commitment to the progress of the race. And he caught a lot of crap. And he said, someone asked him about music, and this was 68, and he said, well, you know, he stiff-armed the jazz term again. And he said, well, the music is African. So, I mean, this is someone who was not, and I'm not impugning anybody, but he didn't, you know, necessarily wear dashikis or anything like that. But he said this, and this is someone who quietly led, with a couple of exceptions, an all-black, it's a business, you know, for 50 years. And he also said, you know, what I do in terms of commitment is in the music. So you have to look at another side of Ellington, Harlem Airshaft, portrait of Florence Mills, the second portrait of the great pianist, Willie the Lion Smith, the Liberian Suite, black, brown, and beige, all those things. So he walked it like he talked it, you know, walked like Toussaint just did, you know, so you got that thing, but it wasn't the only thing. And for a geeky kid like myself, hyper curious, to be aware of someone who was themselves, back to Lester Young, original, boy, yeah, that's, you know, it still means a heck of a lot to me, because it's, you have to be, well, again, Lester Young, you've got to be original, man, right? Okay, stop me, I brought up Baptist ministers, and we can stretch the bubble gum a little bit. Another key interpreter, the Ellington sound, alto saxophonist Johnny Hodges, who was born in Cambridge, Massachusetts. Duke Ellington said he was often responsible for, he called it excruciating ecstasy. This piece was written by Billy Strayhorn, and it's called Isfahan. Now, Isfahan is a city and a province in Iran. This is, you know, I made reference to irony and the United States' involvement with the East. What Duke Ellington would say at the introduction of this piece in concert was, you know, in Isfahan, everything is poetry. And you can compare and contrast that to, you know, like the State Department sends the orchestra overseas. What's the historical record when it comes to the government's relationship with Iran? So it could either be this or either or both and, which maybe that's how you could define American history, both and. But this, if I get this right, this is called Isfahan. Johnny Hodges is the soloist. Oops. Oops, sorry, we heard that. Skip. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Oh, shoot. That's so weird. I apologize, you all. Yeah, right. Well, I could say I'm tap dancing, but I can't dance. One, two. Thank you for your humor. Johnny Hodges, Johnny Hodges and Isfahan, which is, again, a province and a city in... That's okay. Good to see you. Take care now. All righty. Bye-bye. A city and a province in Iran, featuring Johnny Hodges, alto saxophone. This was another interpersonal, like, kind of a contentious relationship, Duke Ellington, Johnny Hodges, but again, he was so integral to the sound, and I can think of other ballads written by Billy Strayhorn, Passion Flower. Oh gosh, there's a beautiful, the Shakespearean suite from 1957, it's a piece inspired by Romeo and Juliet. Paul Gonzalez, whom we heard on Tourist Point of View, Johnny Hodges, called The Star-Crossed Lovers, also written by Billy Strayhorn. A lot of yearning, beautiful, but not mawkish or sentimental contributions. There's also a clip on YouTube of Ellington and the orchestra playing Isfahan, and if you've ever seen the orchestra during that time, or you know about Johnny Hodges, he was very deadpan, you know, like, he's up there playing, he's breaking, you know, even statues are crying, right? And but he's playing this beautiful stuff, and you think, wow. But, you know, to quote another composition by Duke Ellington, ain't but the one. So Johnny Hodges, a piece written by Billy Strayhorn entitled Isfahan. There are 9 movements in this piece, and I wanted to give you a taste. You know, hopefully this will make you delve or inspire you to delve further. What I want to close with and leave it up for questions, this is a little bit longer and I want to play it. It features the piano player, as Duke Ellington often self-effacingly referred to, you know, himself as. And Jimmy Hamilton returns again. This piece is called Ad Lib on Nippon. Now, I was looking through some older reviews of the suite, and one of the kind of, I thought sort of a snarky criticism of it was that, you know, how could it be the Far East if a piece inspired by Japan was part of it? And I mean, you know, critics have license, just like, you know, we talk about poetic license and all that. But once again, though, the commitment to excellence and the use of another brilliant soloist, the way this piece will, it starts one place orally, rhythmically, you know, piano, John Lamb on bass, and then Jimmy Hamilton comes in. But, well, you know, all our ears are different. I think it works very well. And it's maybe another side, too, of Duke Ellington as a pianist. And before I go to it, I'll offer another quote from Clark Terry, who played trumpet and flugelhorn in the orchestra in like the mid to late 50s. He said, when it comes to piano, you don't mess with the old man. And, you know, he meant that lovingly, because he was an inspiration to people who may seem like disparate children, musically speaking, people like Cecil Taylor, but they would, you know, speak highly of Duke Ellington. And again, during my time working with those papers, I'd look at these scores and you'd think, how did he get away with this? And I won't saddle you with a bunch of nerdy technical stuff about music, but you'd have a chord, you know, like clusters, and you think, wait, that note doesn't, if you have any kind of musical training, it's like, that doesn't work. But somehow, you know, like a high wire act, you think it's going like this, and then it would right itself. Or maybe the point was to make it fall. But I think Ellington at his best, Ellington and Strayhorn made it work. And, you know, how do you sell a revolution? And I think they did that. A lot of radical things happening within the context of pieces, but, you know, it's got, I'll use this term loosely, it's got the groove always, even if it's a ballad. So this is Ad Lib on Nippon, and I hope to get us here before next Wednesday night. Thought we had it. Jimmy Hamilton, clarinet, of course, Duke Ellington, piano, Rufus Speedy Jones on drums, sorry about that, and John Lamb on bass, Rufus Speedy Jones. Again, ad lib on Nippon. I think of something my very deadpan father would say. He was, you know, the reputation Calvin Coolidge had, give you like three words every 6 months. My father would say, that was pretty good. And that's, you know, but that's the last movement of the Far East Suite, and again, I think it's, you know, it's a testament to the range, what the rappers used to call the mad skills of Duke Ellington, Billy Strayhorn, and how, what they were able to contribute with that orchestra. One of the vocalists with the orchestra, particularly in the 1940s, a guy also did cowboy movies, the Bronze Buckaroo, Herb Jeffrey, said he thought the orchestra was one of the greatest examples of communication in the history of mankind. So obviously a statement like that goes beyond thinking about genre and all those sorts of things. I do think about the orchestra and how what one learns about people in an ensemble, an organization, it could be a corporation, whatever, you have different personalities. That orchestra had curmudgeons and kleptomaniacs and all sorts of things. Whatever their problems or challenges were when they got on that bandstand, boom, or in the studio, you know, it's a singular effort. And as I said before, even the people who had beef with Ellington and used semi up-to-date parlance said, you know, that music. And that too, so this is a taste of this particular work in 1960s. Recorded 66, released 1967, inspired by the inspiration during that aborted tour of the Middle and Far East in 1963. One last thing I'll say and open it up for any further questions or comments. Do any of you remember when they had music in the public schools, you know, like band and orchestra? Okay, DC Public was fourth grade, and I wanted to play violin, but the band teacher said, no, men don't play violin. And well, I won't tell you, my mother went to school the next day and said, you never heard of Yasha Heifetz and all these people, blah, blah. Anyway, I ended up B-flat clarinet. My father had purchased this album, and he said, oh, listen to this, Jimmy Hamilton. And I'm playing, I'm listening to this guy play. You assemble the clarinet, I'm looking at it thinking, these keys aren't on this instrument. It's just not, and that was my excuse. Like, you know, no. He had a custom made, and again, my church father just said, talent, practice, boom, the zen of my father. Anyway, but that's, again, like a taste of this extended work. I'll open it up again for to you all if you have any questions or comments. Yes?
You could definitely, for me, I could hear the kabuki in the beginning of that. Mm-hmm. You know, I could almost visualize, again, you know, the fan, you know, the dancing and that kind of thing. And then, of course, he threw me for a loop when he, like, you know, sped it up in that middle.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, hearing the drums again, and then the clarinet being, to me, again, reminiscent of Far Eastern, but Japanese music is that flute that they use a lot.
Ah, yeah.
You know?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So it's again in that kabuki range.
Sure.
But, I had never listened to it that closely before. Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. No, that's, thank you. No, every time I play this, I hear something different.
Right.
And what I heard this time, and you know, there's obviously an extension of those initial motifs Ellington plays on piano. At first it sounds almost like a minor key blues, like stop the nerd, you know, it's like the one, and then it goes to the four chord, which is like standard rock. And then, you know, there's some other stuff going on, but then, you know, Jimmy Hamilton starts, and those trills mm-hmm. are an extension of what was being done on the piano. And this was not happenstance, you know, but it's, Duke Ellington also said, he said, you know, music, it's about listening. And, you know, you can compose something, but I think that people don't use this term anymore, that synergy between these players and that, anyway. Yes?
You know, when I first started hearing the music, and they had these two different riffs going on, and you were talking about how they were going to bridge it, and they did, I was seeing, like, Caldera, like, mobiles and modern art. I saw where you gave us that his desire to paint. I saw that as very painterly, but like you, all of a sudden I saw a dancer. But at first, like it kind of calmed down and you got that four beat and it seemed more rhythmic. I started seeing like those movies, the dancers in the movies, like we all saw, you know, in the movies. And then I saw like Martha Graham influence on the dancers, and then they were not dancing like kick, kick, please.
Right.
It was more like Martha Graham at that point, because mm-hmm. I was visualizing dancers.
Yes.
And I, so to me, that was like a whole experience of like modern art and music. Mm-hmm. I saw so many influences. And thank you for the kabuki thing, because I was reaching for how did I go from Showgirls to like Martha Graham? And it was like the kabuki.
Wow. Speaking of which, of sounds, where are you from? Okay, you said modern art. You had me at the short A's. I mean, anyway, no, I love that. I love that. No. I had a college professor who would say, music professor, he'd say, you know a lot about what's going on now, Mr. Jackson, but you don't know standards.
Yeah.
Yeah. And sometimes I pretend like I didn't know what he was saying, yes, so I could hear him say it again.
Well, my youngest daughter has a hit list of when she's feeling down, she makes me repeat certain words, like scissors. She just thinks that.
Oh, man. See, as a poet, it's, you know, like that movie, it's the sound of music, which is what we've been listening to tonight. It's the sound of music. Thank you. You've made my Wednesday. Yeah, okay. All right.
I tell you one thing. I'll end on this. When I came to Vermont in 86, I was like, oh, they put R's on the end of the word. And I asked me to chop them up. So I was like, okay. And then, so people made fun of me for a long time.
No. You're good. You're good. Any last comment? Yes, sir.
How many people generally were in the orchestra? Did he ever sing himself, or did he have an accompanying singer? Mm-hmm. I guess I'll just stay with
that's okay. I'm going to do quick old school counting here for this particular date. There's 15 here. Now, Ellington did small group sessions. He did, quote, sing a piece recorded 1969 after the first moon landing. It's called Moon Maiden. And it was really more kind of half sung, half spoken. But the orchestra had a series of vocalists throughout its career, its lineage. So Herb Jeffries was the 40s. You had Kay Davis and, oh my gosh, Ivy Anderson, a number. You know, I think also the Ellington Orchestra, like Orson Welles's Mercury Theater players, and you'd have certain people who would make these contributions. And he was, you know, he would play pieces like excerpts from the Far East Suite in concert, but he always played, to use my teacher's phrasing, the standards, you know, Mood Indigo, that sort of thing. So people got a varied experience. And he knew also that the hits made it possible for him to experiment more, you know. But what a guy.
I'm reminded, and especially following like his experiment, throughout this album, but definitely that last piece, I'm reminded of just how out he was.
Oh yeah.
Out there.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And how, especially thinking of the time,
yeah,
when
yeah,
the younger players at the time, Coltrane, whoever, mm-hmm. I hope Coltrane never felt like this. I don't think he could have. But I imagine a lot of the younger players, you know, thought of Ellington as like old school.
Passé. Oh yeah, sure, sure.
But when you hear this, especially with that opening on piano, mm-hmm, I'm hearing Monk.
Right.
Yes. I'm hearing the whole lineage, which I think is wonderful.
Yeah, yeah.
I love that. And when I started playing the clarinet and was listening to Jimmy Hamilton, I said the same thing. These notes are.
Yeah. Oh yeah. 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 I did the same thing with guitar and Jimi Hendrix. I said, no, it's like especially, you know. And my father just said, talent, you know. So don't quit your day job, son. So that's where my quarter into the parking meter with the music. I thank you all for coming. I'm sorry for the glitches here, but I really learned so much from your observations. And again, you know, I'm still the kid in the basement playing the records, and thank you for not rolling your eyes like, Reuben, please stop.
You came to the basement willingly.
There you go. I think this phase of my life is, I say it lovingly, it's nerd's revenge, you know, and it's, boy. So again, thank you so much. Thanks to the Humanities Council, and as my French teacher, Madame Rosenblum, would say, écoutez, listen, you know, listen to more Ellington, listen to more music. I think we need it, you know, for many reasons. So thank you again.
We have refreshments in the Vermont room. Please come on in and have some coffee or tea or hot chocolate.
Or some water.
That I do not have. Hot apple cider.
Cider.
And homemade pumpkin bread.
Oh, I got two pieces already.
When it good. Oh, hello. Yeah.
Come for the music, stay for the pumpkin.
So thank you all for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Partnership. I'm glad we talked about.